Very good evening to everyone. I am Raj Samala here from TIE Hyderabad, and we have another very interesting topic: hydroponics, hyperlocal farming strategies. And I couldn't be more excited about the panel that we have got. Two young guys, had great careers, and then they are doing into this. And we have got Vijay, who is going to be the moderator, who is the CEO of AgriTech Hub. It's an agri innovation hub which works in a hub and spoke model that promotes agri-tech startups and innovations. And basically, they also work on the rural entrepreneurship through their rural innovation centers and all. And he's also set up multiple innovation bridges and help startup in the agri-tech sector, incubators, accelerator, and also has done some seed funding and all. And we have got two great young guys, Satya and Vihari. And they have got good success stories to share with them. And Vijay, all yours. And you'll get a queue in 45th minute and questions, and then from there. Thank you.
Sure. Thanks, Raj and Tai, for calling me in as a moderator. It's great to be part of the Elite panel and, of course, to talk on the emerging subject, hydroponics, and also the areas of sustainable farming approaches that we're going to talk. Let me have the privilege to introduce two panelists. One, Vihari. I have a long association with Vihari personally. Of course, we've been working together as a part of his journey at Urban Kisan. Vihari is a certified management accountant who got into a social vision of creating a hydroponics venture. With this background, he co-founded Urban Kisan with his other co-founders, Dr. Sairam, and others. He's started this company, who has worked on various streamlined processes of building hydroponics into the mainstream. At least four, 5 years back, when we started the journey, hydroponics was something kind of seen as something which is little elite. But now he's tried to evangelize the whole concept of hydroponics. Today, Urban Kisan is a brand and a known name in the startup space, and also a very established player in the urban farming and, of course, the hydroponics space. And with this, Vihari also has a couple of accolades. He's one of the top 100 emerging innovative companies by Forbes, and also listed as top 5 most influential projects for India in 2020 by PMI and Economic Times Award for Startup of the Year 2021. And I guess this company, Urban Kisan, is one of the very few Indian agri-tech startups that has been able to make it to the Y Combinator, one of the largest accelerators in the world. So thanks, Vihari. You brought a good amount of fame for agri-tech and also for Hyderabad as a destination in Telangana, of course. So we love you, and I'm sure that we'll have a lot of story to hear. On the contrary, we have another interesting entrepreneur who completely goes rural and, of course, on the semi-urban spaces, but he has some interesting things to do. So let me take this privilege to introduce Satya Raghu, who is a co-founder and president of Kheti and Cosmos Green. This is a startup which is working for the benefit of small and marginal farmers to help them rise out of poverty. Because I've been interacting with Satya for quite some time, though, his vision and kind of enterprise focus on building a social impact enterprise has been deep-rooted. And he's a CA turned farmer and also an agri entrepreneur. Satya is a 2014 Acumen Fellow, a 2016 Aspen New Voices Fellow, and 2018 Rainer Anhold Fellow, and TED 2021 Fellow. He's a passionate teacher and frequent Himalayan motorbiker. Very interesting. I didn't know this. Yeah, but he's a panel member in Banishing Hunger at Aspen Ideas Festival and Acumen India Fellow, Aspen New Voices Fellow, teacher, and public speaker. So I'm sure that Satya wears a lot of hats, as we could hear from this introduction. So with these introductions, I'm sure that there's a lot more exciting story to hear from how these young guys started this whole lot of energy. And most interestingly, both of them are actually CAs, and they come to agriculture. What made you guys into this thing? Let me understand, and for the benefit of the audience. So let me start with Vihari at Urban Kisan. So what is that made you feel that it's the need of the hour to be able to get into hydroponics and start this kind of business? So tell us, in a way, the startup story of Urban Kisan and what made you or got you to this, and how has been the whole story. Over to you, Vihari.
Hey, thank you. Thank you for the very warm, introduction you've given me. So I think we go back to, I think in 2016, when I met Vijay, I had no clue about agriculture. He mentioned, I don't come from the science background. I almost hated science when I was a kid. Me not knowing anything in the space, primarily, you become curious on everything you see in the space. Right. So that's how that curiosity led to, you know, me meeting Sairam, Dr. Sairam, my partner. So he's a scientist. So he used to grow, you know, hydroponically all leafy greens in his balcony. And at that point of time, I didn't even know the word hydroponics. Right. So it was more, it was so fascinating to me that actually plants can grow without soil, because all my life, at least as far as I read science, it needed soil. So that kind of blew me as soon as I saw that in his home garden, full of, it was a jungle with all growing without, you know, soil. So that made me ask a very curious question. Why isn't everybody doing this, right? You're telling me that this saves 95% lesser water. It doesn't use soil. It can give you, you know, 10 times better yield. Then isn't it a no-brainer solution that every farmer out there or every anybody out there should be ideally doing this and not anything else, because it's far more advantageous than traditional farming. So he gave me a couple of answers. One is it's very costly, and unless you have good amount of money, you will not be able to, you know, do this. Second thing is he said that the technology has only evolved to grow leafy greens like lettuce or you know, basil or spinach or so on. So I said, okay, I only asked him, can we grow other plants? He said, technically you can, because, you know, it's all science. So I said, okay, great, then I'm in. So that's how I pursued him to convince him to join the startup, saying, I think we can build something here, because the opportunity is massive. Because every time you read a report, any sustainability summit you attend, anything you say, everybody says the world is going down, but I don't see any action happening on the agriculture side, especially on water or even soil. You from agri space, you see every day that a lot of startups are actually now getting into ag space. Now the ag ecosystem is heating up in India, but 4 years back, it was nothing. It was hardly 3-4 startups who were making some noise. So that's pretty much it. The whole idea of Urban Sun started from the curiosity of me not knowing hydroponics. So, yeah.
Interesting. I think from that stage, not only you as a founder and the Urban Kisan as a startup grew, and obviously the whole ecosystem also grew. Today, for the benefit of the audience, there are more than 3,200 startups registered under the Startup India Initiative. These are all agri-tech startups. Yeah. Plus, there are 700 mature startups under NASSCOM, and yeah, good amount of startups that are still sprawling in. So let's hear from...
The whole hydroponic space has grown because... now, if you see, even if you open Swiggy, Instamart or Dunzo, there's a separate category called hydroponics where they're selling the produce under this. So,
yeah.
It's a lot.
Interesting. And not just you, man, you who understood agriculture from us, we also learned the way hydroponics can be looked upon as the horticulture guy. When we were taught by our faculty, it was seemed to be something which was a science fiction story, but it's really made into actionable. So thanks for getting hydroponics into the mainstream and not many players like you who are actually trying to have the unseen story of the hydroponics into the mainstream. So let's hear from Satya. Satya, I mean, I understand what you're trying to do is largely for the social impact, working for the farmers. So how do you see, just let us understand your startup journey. I understand building something of this sort of agriculture infrastructure and bringing some huge value to the small farmers is not that easy. So how are you building the small farmers to the smart farmers? And can we call it as a movement that what is that you're trying to build in this space? Can you just help the audience know about how difficult it has been and how you have coped up with this challenge to bring the impact story? Over to you.
Right. Thanks, Vijay. Good stuff, Vihari. I think it was a good beginning to this conversation. So my journey started when I was about 22. I was working in PwC as a chartered accountant. And then I moved out to you know, with an intention to start something in the agriculture space. So the first and foremost question that I had in front of me was, what would I do? I knew that I want to spend my time in agriculture space, but what exactly would I do? So I personally had no idea. And I spent a year traveling to understand different agriculture technologies and different farming practices. The more I traveled, the more I got confused. And that... Finally, there came a moment where I felt, I think I have to become a farmer. Otherwise, whatever problem, because I wanted to get into farming fundamentally to make the math of agriculture work for a smallholder farmer. So I'm a chartered accountant. So I wanted to find a way to make the math of agriculture work. Because when we just keep hearing all these stories, like Vihari was saying, it's all like a doomsday prediction of, oh, these farmers are dying. Every farm, like 3 out of 4 farmers are quitting farming. So that's not a pleasant thing. Like, but why? Why does it happen? Like at the root cause level, where is the issue? So for us to understand that, that's where, in fact, my journey before Kheti started with Cosmos Green, where my co-founder Ayush and I, we started Cosmos Green, where we fundamentally began our work in agriculture being farmers ourselves, along with an advisor called Mr. Raghavan. That taught us over 4 years that in open field farming, how much ever you do, the number of variables are just so many that if anybody learned probability in school, they shouldn't do farming. Right? They shouldn't do open field farming at least. It was all the probabilities were against a farmer succeeding. So that got me to thinking, hey, what are the risks which are affecting the farmer and how can these risks be mitigated? That is when we started the Kheti journey, Kaushik, Soumya, Ayush and I, we spent again 6 months traveling to understand really what the smallholder farmers suffer from. Because interventions which sound good in a lab, which don't make any sense to farmers, is not what we wanted to build. We wanted to build solutions which get to understand the unmet and unarticulated needs of smallholder farmers and actually problem solve them. So that journey got us to understand that the climate risk is a massive piece which is unaddressed. And the funny story is whenever you ask farmer, who is going to solve this? What is an alternative for you? They just say, God, I mean, excess heat. God is the solution. God is the problem. God is the solution. Unseasonal rains, pests, all these. So basically, for elements which are beyond farmers' control, quite understandably, the only person that they could blame and also have hope in was God. So we said, how can this be more real? How can it not be that abstract? How can it be real? And that is when we said, we can cover these finite number of elements with this kind of a technology, but it has to be small enough for it to sit in a smallholder farmer's land, cheap enough for them to afford, and easy enough for them to use. So that's the thinking which got us to start Kheti, and we are laser focused on adding about close to $80 to $100, roughly about 6,000 to 7,000 or 8,000 rupees of extra profit every month to the farmer. That is how we measure our success.
Interesting. I think what you try to do is to kind of bring or evangelize the whole concept of low-cost greenhouses, which is a very interesting dimension to the kind of rural farmers, you know, because the rural infrastructure is always deemed to be a very challenging aspect for the small and marginal farmers, looking at the aspect that more than almost 85% farmers are small and marginal of the country. But yeah, very interesting things to learn. But yeah, as we go more, we have a lot more things to share. So let me ask Vihari on the other side. Especially in a country like India, where hydroponics is an emerging subject, and especially we're a country where we have a huge land bank, of course, and there are farmers who are doing a traditional farming. So what have been your challenges when you started building this whole concept of hydroponics in terms of its acceptance by its customers, in terms of cost effectiveness, acceptance of the technology, or in terms of propagating this whole technology? What's been your experience, Vihari?
So when we started back with Sairam, the first thing we did is we built a farm of hydroponics, so because we wanted to go through the journey ourselves, very similar to, you know, his, right? So we built the whole farm out, and we also wanted to make a point that these farms can be built anywhere, so we built our first farm in the heart of the city, which is in Jubilee Hills, just to say that, hey, it's urban farming. And so that was one of the most propagating factor of, you know, the topic being spoken in the town, that there's something new, there's a farm in the city, and you can actually go and harvest it yourself, right? And so that brought us a lot of PR, right? So you, no matter how much ads you do, no matter how much performance marketing you do, or anything, right? Nothing speaks louder than what you see as a customer, right? So if I just say that, hey, I am growing hydroponics, I save this much water, for the customer, it'll be like, okay, so what, right? So rather, if you're able to show and mesmerize him with how you're growing it hydroponically, and show him the freshness, show him the experience of buying something off the farm, that's gonna speak 1,000 words more than what you've actually spoken. If you see, we've never Edward, if you visit any of our stores of any of our farms, even our website, we never talk the word organic. We never use the word organic. But if you call any of our customers, the first thing they'll say is Urban Kisan is organic, right? So that is a notion that has come in, not because we've derived it, not in our marketing language. It's just visibly, it looks fresh. So for a customer, organic is what? Organic is pesticide-free, organic is fresh, and that is the notion. So when you see something that good, it drives the customer up. So I think more than marketing spends, I think majority of the money we've spent is on building farms in and around the city to create the buzz about hydroponics. It's that brought in a lot of PR. And when we started, the most difficult part of it was, in fact, not the growing bit of it, was actually selling the hydroponic produce. Because back in 2017, people did not pay you premium. People did not pay you anything extra for you growing cleaner, fresher, no pesticide produce. They in fact paid you the same as what a mandi would pay. So we thought, okay, and also in fact retailers were refusing to take the produce, they were in fact loading the wastage on us. So all of that was not working out. Like I said, the math never worked out if we had to give it to B2B players. So we said, okay, fine, let's just sell it directly to consumers. And that's where we took the stand of becoming a D2C company than a B2B, because we realized the margin and the value, people who value, is where you have to sell your produce or anything as such, right? So that's why we started our journey as a B2C brand. Yeah. Those were a few challenges which came up. Yeah.
Yeah. It's very interesting to note the concept you propagated, farming as an experience, because it's something which the urban dwellers or urban people should be able to relate to, because it's not a common experience which people have, number one. Number two, it's also the kind of closer look I was lucky enough to have with you, Vihari, as a part of the incubation, you know, when we were seeing a lot of pivots that were happening, you know, we were just pivoting as per how the people accept it in terms of, because it's completely a new storyboard for the urban set of customers. And most interestingly, you know, the twists and turns you have taken to smartly right across the startup journey to be able to propagate a new concept and reach here. I'm sure that there's a lot of effort that has gone into. Kudos to your whole team. So, but yeah, urban is a little different story, but rural is actually a little complex, and especially when there's a deep-rooted ecosystem, you know, when there's already a deep-rooted ecosystem, the public institutions, universities, research ecosystem, and a lot of agri guys like me who are around. And when Satya suddenly enters there, being a non-ag hat, I'm sure a lot of efforts would have gone in understanding what it takes to be an agri entrepreneur. And I'm sure that Satya would have evaluated, you know, what could be the probable solution before you actually boil down to this particular solution, what you're offering today. I'm sure there could be a chaotic situation when Satya was figuring out what is that I need to kind of offer in kind of designing an apt impact solution that suits a rural farmer or largely a marginalized or poor farmers. So how did the ecosystem work? What made you think, and what are the kind of initiatives you initially planned and how you pivoted and reached here? Can you just explain us the process a little bit? Yeah.
Sure. I think one thing hasn't changed from the time we started. That is our laser focus on adding a reliable close to $100 of extra profit to the smallholders family. So that is one thing which hasn't changed. Everything else changed. So we originally had some thoughts on the type of greenhouse, or first of all, whether it should be greenhouse or not, because we are never married to the idea of greenhouse. We were married to the idea of how can reliably, dependably, that $100 of extra profit come to the smallholder's family. So that is what we got married to. So in that, as we started understanding, as I said already, the big chunk was the climate risk. So for that climate risk, we thought of the simple solution, which could mitigate a bulk of climate risk, because it's always, you know, a price sensitive market with smallholders, where you have to take the trade-off between you know, is it a must have or a good to have. So all those happened, and then when really in terms of the ecosystem, what we learned, like the biggest learning, is smallholder farmers wouldn't succeed just if I go and give a greenhouse to them and say boom, go for it, right, we installed it for you. They can fail at every step, right? They can fail because of lack of access to quality seed, or lack of access to quality advisory, or, you know, inputs, safe inputs for them to grow safe produce, and the market intelligence. So most importantly, access to finance. Like, you know, if I'm selling these greenhouses to an urban farmer or a rich farmer, then my problem is very different. How do I convince them? They have money, how do I convince them? But here the problem is very different. They really want to buy, but they don't probably have like the 20,000 rupees in their pocket to pay for it. So how do you get an asset, a life-changing asset, into the hands of a smallholder by kind of connecting these dots? So that has been a fascinating journey. So in that process, what we didn't want to compromise on was, just because somebody is a smallholder farmer, it does not mean they deserve bad quality stuff. Small also deserve goods and services with dignity. So we wanted to find a way to incentive align the ecosystem. I think this is the most important thing we have done. We try to incentive align the ecosystem so that the biggest players, like greenhouses, we never invented greenhouses, right? So greenhouses have been in the world for maybe like 50, 60, 80 years. So how can the best greenhouse company in the world, or some one of the best greenhouse companies in the world, utilize, lend its resources to design this kind of a solution? How can one of the best seed companies in the world think about these farmers? How can a large bank think about lending to these smallholder farmers? So that way, essentially what we try to do is, we create, I mean, again, it's not based on charity. So it has to be a win-win. How do we create a relevant win-win for everybody that they see potential? Because all said and done, out of close to 120 million smallholder farmers, 120 million farmers we have in India, close to 100 million of them, 10 crores of them are smallholder families, right? And into four or five, on an average, about 40, 50 crore people live there. So that's a big number you have to think about. So it's a big market. If you put it in business terms, it's a big market. But how do you design solutions for that market? How do you make money in a game where farmer also makes money? I think this incentive alignment is the calibration that we continue to do. And probably this is going to be for a journey forever, that calibration.
Very interesting. We draw the very interesting inference that, you know, you started with the greenhouse and also you wanted to benefit the actual farmers. But the journey, you know, is very tough. I'm sure there's a lot of thinking, there's a lot of interactions you had, the empathy, you know, that you had with the farmers to understand the affordability, accessibility, and take a decentralized approach of actually evangelizing this concept. You know, when we as students, when we were reading, greenhouse seemed to be something like a very, very elite kind of concept. It doesn't actually relate to the Indian farming context. I think you were just trying to bring down the context to something which is more Indianized version of something which should relate, or the farmers could relate to. I think very interesting perspective added.
I want to add one more point here, Vijay. So as you rightly said, greenhouse was always like a minimum of 40, 50 lakh rupees you pay and you had access to a greenhouse, right? Our greenhouse today, the latest model that we launched is, you know, is sub 1 lakh rupees. And this is the first time ever in the world a sub 1 lakh rupees greenhouse has been designed in 1/10 an acre for a smallholder farm. And greenhouses, again, have always been for exotic crops. As Vihari was saying, you know, the things that we hear are, oh, you grow lettuce, right? Sure. You see some farms in the US, Europe, where, you know, you grow salads. But we aren't such a big salad-eating country, right? So we are still tiny in terms of that. So what we do is, we will grow what we eat. So today in our greenhouses, you grow tomatoes, you grow carrot, you grow cabbage, you grow potatoes, you grow onion. So basically, you grow what you eat in India. So that's when the real relevance kicks in. Otherwise, it will continue to be an out there concept, which is only for a tiny 1% of the world or 1% of India, and not a mainstream solution. So we really focused on making this an Indian version, be it in terms of pricing, its relevance, its sizing, and also the crop portfolio.
Very interesting. I think we now have these two young guys, you know, one on the urban side, urban kisan, and the other side, Satya, who is doing something for the rural kisan. You know, the analogy, you see the quite two extremes of it. And thanks, you know, I mean, I've worked with both of you guys to quite good extent as an agri guy, you know. We also could unlearn a lot of the concepts, you know, even for us, hydroponics or greenhouses was something as an elite concept of something for a progressive farmer. This is how we could relate to or understand as when we were reading, when we were in 2003 in our graduation. But exactly after 10 or 15 years down the line, when you were working with you, I think you also brought on some kind of, concept that makes relevant to India and for the Indian farmers, number one. You got the contextualization, number one. Number two, you also got, you know, scaled down the technology. People talk about scaling up of startups, but I'm talking about scaling down the technology to be able to kind of debundle this and make it more affordable, accessible to the customers. It could be an urban customer like what Vihari is doing, or it could be a rural farmer, which Satya is trying to do. Very interesting. So we have something more adding on. So let me ask Vihari on the other side. I know hydroponics is not just a concept anymore. It's more of a technology which has been finding acceptance in India. And also it's going to be a game-changing technology, not just in India, but the way the global trends are growing. But also we are seeing that the hydroponics is going to add some value proposition to the customer in terms of residue-free agriculture, and also it could add to some low carbon footprints. So how do you see the interjection between hydroponics as a technology vis-a-vis the value proposition of being able to be a residue-free agriculture and also something which creates some low carbon footprint kind of scenario? What is your perspective to it? Vihari, over to you.
So, in terms of the technology, right, like he was mentioning, the hydroponics generally meant you can grow lettuce or basil or something which is exotic, because very simple math, right? So if your capital investment is too high, then if your payback has to be within 18 months, then you'll have to grow crops which are very high in value and give you high net margins. And therefore, you're getting you that payback of 18 months. And so if you look at what are the high value crops which can grow is all these exotic leafy greens and exotic vegetables. When we took up the technology, the first thing we brought down the entire capital investment of hydroponics itself, right? So it was almost around 1 crore for an acre, for 1.2, 1.5 crores an acre. So we almost brought it down to about 10 lakhs an acre. That's the cost which we drastically brought it down to. And I have doubled yields for many crops. So we just don't grow lettuce anymore. So we grow almost 100% basket size of fruits, vegetables. The way we were able to do this is not by, you know, taking off the shelf vegetable seeds which are available in the market. Rather, we, because of the Sairam science background, we were able to identify and screen a lot of seed varieties which were suitable for hydroponics. Soil and soilless are two different things, and the same seed might not give you the same yield results which you look at. So what we've created is a large seed bank of a repository of seeds which are suitable to be grown in hydroponics, and that's what we've been doing over the last 3 years, you know, almost growing every crop, every variety as much as possible multiple times to ensure that you know, we're able to grow it hydroponically and even vertically. So today we're almost able to grow tomatoes, for example, in 3 layers. In 3 layers, in 1 acre, we get about 100 tons of yield a month. 100 tons of yield in acre, right? So that's almost 10x or even 15x of what a soil farming can do. An open field soil farming can do, right? So what we are building as a technology, at the end of the day, we want to give it to farmers. As in, so we actually are very, I'm very glad that, you know, Kethi has brought down the greenhouse cost, because that's a huge entry barrier for us. You know, 50 lakh, 60 lakh in polyhouses just doesn't make sense. Even though if I bring down the entire hydroponic cost, if there is no infrastructure available, then it is very hard to deploy. So once the infrastructure is available, these are like plug and play instruments. We can plug in and then increase the yields by 3x, 5x minimum across all plants. Has significantly, we've changed a lot, brought in a lot of IP in tech. And because we are now able to grow all of these crops in hydroponics, and most of it is in controlled environment, the use of pesticides is almost nil, unless, you know, your farm SOPs are not followed and so on. So we kind of, we stick to organic as much as possible to ensure that we are able to grow complete traceability. So in fact, we are also, you know, putting in blockchain just to ensure that our customers have full transparency on how it's grown, where it's grown, how and the whole content of it, so that there's a complete traceability even for the consumers. And that's a project which we're currently working on as well.
Interesting. So that brings in a dimension of, you know, the hydroponics, where you're not just working on engineering product, but also you're working on the crop innovation itself, not only just addressing the sustainability, value proposition to customers, and most importantly, you're also bringing the element of productivity to meet the sustainability and also the food demand, you know, which is very interesting perspective. I'm sure that there's a lot more innovation that will happen in this space with players like you guys in this space. But on the contrary, you know, on the rural space, let me understand from Satya, is what is your broader view as to why we should focus on designing solutions to encourage smallholder farmers? I'm sure the smallholder farmers vis-a-vis these kind of innovative solutions somehow has been a small gap in the ecosystem. How are you trying to address this, Satya? And are there any other solutions also beyond the current solutions that you're thinking across?
Right. So just to be sure that I understood your question, you're talking about why we should design for the smallholder farmers.
Yeah.
So my answer is simple. So agriculture today...
Over to you, please.
So agriculture today, So agriculture today has roughly about 40 to 50%, depending on the statistics who is making, you know, you have about 40 to 50% of people directly, indirectly occupied in farming or farm labor or allied industry. So there is still that sizable segment of people who are employed there. And making agriculture work for smallholder farmers is essential. It's in one way, if you look at it, it's also a moral responsibility to make agriculture work for smallholder farmers. It's unfortunate that we are talking about that as a responsibility to be given. Right? So if there is a big chunk of people who are working, it should be given that it's working for them. But unfortunately, it doesn't work. So the reality is, if you take a 5 years average, there's a study which is done. If you 5 years average farmer household income, they lose money from farming. They don't make money from farming. In a 5 year average, they actually lose money from farming. So if agriculture is so unviable, where are we going to deploy those people? Right? And we know very well how the rest of the ecosystem in the country is in terms of the jobs, etc. So it's not easy. Let's also be fair to that. So the safest and the best way is making a way to getting right technology into the hands of smallholder farmers. As I said, good 100 million smallholder families. It's not a small number. Mm-hmm. And designing for them to make it work. So what we do at Kheti, something that I'm really proud of, is two things. We learn very well. We accept that we know less than what farmers know, and we keep going back to them again and again and again, and we keep listening to them. And there is not a single occasion when I went to a farmer's field or my team went to the farmer's field and we come back saying we haven't learned, right? We just learn loads, like about the service delivery, about small, you know, specs in the product. So that is some fascinating. And second piece is we design our solution keeping smallholder farmer at the center, particularly women farmers. We keep them at the center of our product design. Now, why is this important? I think it's interesting. Today we are talking today, if I'm not wrong, today is the death anniversary of Steve Jobs, right? Design and Steve Jobs are kind of synonymous, right? So the obsession about understanding the customer and keeping the customer at the center of product design is something that he has mastered. And he's a big inspiration, not just to me, but for quite a few people in our leadership team. So we think of how does the smallholder farmer operate this? What kind of ecosystem will be essential for that person to operate? So will there be, you know, again, if I make it 100% digital, 100% high tech, it sounds good. You know, for some part of the funding community, it sounds like, wow, like you should go 100% digital. That is when, you know, your solution would scale up the most. But the larger question to ask is, would farmers get to benefit the most, right? If I go 100% digital. So these are some important things we get to answer, not sitting in an AC room, but by actually going to the field. And we keep the smallholder farmer, particularly women farmer, at the center of our design process, and we build the solution. Like, why do I say women? It is not just for the optics. It is because 60-70% of the work in agriculture is done by women, which goes unnoticed. So when you're designing a product, you should know who is using your product. And that is how we kind of approach our design. And I hope it answers what you asked.
Yeah, pretty much, you know, very interesting, Satya. I think you have largely kind of been adopting the design thinking approaches, getting the empathy, working with the farmer, keeping the farmer at the center of this whole requirement. And then you're designing the whole products, customizing it to their requirements in terms of building your learning process and developing the products. And most interestingly, you brought in the angle of woman entrepreneurship, especially someone who has watched agriculture from closer quarter. There's a lot of role that the women farmers actually play on the ground. Usually we people in the city have a mindset that, okay, it is only the men farmer who contribute to agriculture, which is wrong. Actually, if you go on the field, equally, the women are equally responsible, but women farmers who are contributing to agriculture, which is a very important and interesting dimension you brought around. But I'm sure that as an entrepreneur, you have quite a good learning experience, not just the current solutions. I'm sure you must be doing something very good, innovations that could be in the pipeline for the women farmers. We look forward for such kind of innovations from you, Satya, as we go forward. Now, let me move towards the needle towards Vihari. There are two questions I'll add in the interest of time. One, because hydroponics is an emerging space, I'm sure that as Urban Kisan also has a good track record of raising investments. How do you see this whole hydroponic space in terms of attracting investments? Number one. Number two is, what is the social impact? Do you see any social impact angle to this hydroponics technology with respect to its benefit to rural youth and women? I would like you to answer on this both. Yeah.
I think in terms of the fundraise, be it hydroponics or be it the whole ag space, I think there have been a lot of reports which clearly show that the next couple of years is all about ag, right? And that's a trend which is going to continue for the next couple of years, because a lot of innovation has been happening over the last 4 years, 5 years in this space. So what funding rounds you hear in the news is not something which is happening overnight. People have been working on these projects. People have been working on these startups for like 3-4 years, and now it's shaping up. And people have achieved their MVPs. People have achieved a certain kind of attraction, be it customers or number of farmers or number of yields or transaction. At the end of the day, how much revenue we make is what matters, be it for whether, because none of us are running an NGO, right? So at the end of the day, that's what matters. And I think as an industry, this is something which is shaping up very, very nicely. We see a lot of investments. We know a lot of our colleagues who are in the ag space are all in the midst of fundraising and so on. So it's in a great space. I think the second question was in terms of the social impact. So at this point, what we are primarily focused on is making hydroponics as affordable as traditional farming. So that's our benchmark, right? So if I have to grow tomatoes of 1 acre in open field versus 1 acre of hydroponic, it has to cost me the same, or probably 1 lakh more or 2 lakh more max. Our goal is to bring that cost there and ensure that the technology, starting from seeds to entire automation, which runs the farm on its own. We want to bring all of that in place before we even start approaching farmers saying, hey, here's something, which is going to change your life. But I think that's going to take about one and a half year from now, because we've been working on quite a bit of projects at an individual, SQ level. That is, we're selecting a few crops which are most grown in India, be it okra or be it, tomatoes or brinjals, and all of these were widely cultivated, especially in Andhra and Telangana and in the south. We've been working on these and comparing yields between traditional open field greenhouse versus hydroponics. We're trying to see as much impact as possible on this hydroponic space as such. Once the technology is ready, and then it's going to impact quite a number of lives, because I think the revenue impact for the farmers is going to be incremental from if the technology is deployed. So that's what we focused at this point. So
thank you, Vihari. So let me ask Satya very two interesting things. I'm just going back again to the whole story of how do you get into this whole space of social impact and delivering something for the rural farmers. Satya, what are the key challenges or levers that you see in designing intervention or a technology for smallholder farmers, number one? I would also want you to request, is there any other emerging business models you're seeing in the agri-tech space or in these kind of innovations when it comes to the smart farming. In the interest of time, I would request you to kind of answer these both, and then I would have a summarization and we get to the Q&A. Over to you, please.
Right. So when you design assets for farmers, smallholder farmers, I think the biggest thing that you have to bear in mind is your innovation will be a boutique, tiny innovation, unless there is financing embedded into it, right? That to me is like number one. So what everybody gets is, of course, your solution should work, right? Once it is deployed in the farmer's field, your solution should work. There is no debate, you know, whether it is the greenhouse that Vihari is deploying, whether the hydroponic system that Vihari is deploying or greenhouse that IMD is deploying, you know, it has to work. So that is table stakes. But to get to that, I think this financing is a super critical piece. And to me, that is a game changer. And we have been, we have had our own fair share of learnings on cracking that financing. We thought it could happen with public sector banks. We signed up with large public sector banks, and then we realized that it doesn't work like that because of 100 reasons, and that can be a discussion for another webinar. And then we designed it using an NBFC solution, non-banking finance company. So this is a solution now. We recently signed up with a leading NBFC in agri space called Samunati, where we are rolling this out in a big way to our smallholder farmers. So that to me is the real game changer, or a lever, if I put it like that. That's the challenge, and you crack it, that's a big lever to make it happen. So the other point regarding the business model, something that's been crossing my mind, and we've been thinking about doing some pilots, is this pay as you grow model. So in Africa, this pay as you go has, you know, in solar has been a big disruption, right? So in agriculture, we can think of something like a pay as you grow. I mean, again, I don't take credit for this. My co-founder Kaushik first coined this. So something in that space where farmers don't feel that it is debt, but they essentially, it's like a variable payment. You know, I get it and I pay it. So I earn it and I pay it. So how can an incentive aligned model happen like that, where there is greater reason for us to give great service, and there is also greater reason for farmer to do good work? So, and how can this happen at scale, not just with 100, 200,000 farmers, but how can this happen with like a million farmers, 10 million farmers? So that is what, you know, is an interesting thing that's been running in my mind.
Very interesting. I think you guys actually feel energy in this space, you know, for last 45 minutes, this whole forum, you know, I'm sure brought in a very, very diverse perspectives. On one side, Vihari talks about the urban kisan, the urban enthusiast, hobbyist who have never been with farming, getting into hydroponics and that too with a new technology. He's held us with the whole, how the journey started, the technologies, they themselves learn hydroponics, also made the entrepreneur, their customers learn about it, and also work with the ecosystem, the awareness, the technology infusion, working on agriculture, bringing agriculture closer to the hydroponics technology and making it more impactful as a technology which is acceptable, affordable, and figuring out a right model, taking right pivots at right time, also working with the global partners, global forums, and bringing this whole concept, you know. And today, hydroponics space, the whole team of Vihari, the Urban Kisan, they have come up with wide diverse models. Yeah, on one side, they have their own stores. Other side, they also have kids. On the other side, they also have their own hydroponically grown veggies on distribution. You know, I mean, that whole model which has evolved, you see, in less than 4 or 5 years, where hydroponics was just in books in India. And now you're evangelizing this whole concept. Kudos to you, Vihari. On other side, you know, Satya, what he's been trying to do very interestingly, and that too in a challenging space in agriculture, that too in the actual farmer space, you know, the rural farmer, who's the actual farmer. Being a non-farmer, Satya himself goes to the farmers and brings something which is more, you know, amicable as a solution to the rural farmers. Especially the agri-infrastructure space has been a challenging domain for the governments, for the corporates to deal with. In such a challenging space and with the farmer who is not able to afford, the Satya and team at Kheti has been able to come up across a very amicable solution, at not only affordable or a low-cost solution, but also something which keeps farmer at the center of mind while developing the solutions and while innovating, and also understanding the farmer's ecosystem. I'm sure there were a lot of papers which are taken. I'm sure there were a lot of thinking that went into in terms of understanding who is the real beneficiary, how to make it accessible, and also very interestingly, you know, pay as you grow. I mean, this is one learning I take from you. I mean, thanks to your co-founder Satya, this is very interesting. You know, this is a concept, the empathy angle that has to come. You know, because there's not everything that could be commercial. On one side, the urban kisan kind of models, which caters to the urban farmers, could be a commercial model of looking at things. But on the other side, contrarily, when we talk about kheti, we're talking about rural farming. Maybe that ecosystem works with the pay as you grow kind of model. Where definitely, I mean, both the ecosystems are very pertinent. Both of you guys are doing something which is more pertinent, something which is more relevant to your stakeholders or your customers in a way. But I'm sure you guys are doing great in both of your spaces. And Hyderabad is proud of you guys because you guys represent Hyderabad and Telangana as an ecosystem. But nevertheless, as a stakeholder, as an agriculture point of view, you're trying to work on two different extremes from farm to fork, completely opposite to each other, because in terms of the way you are catering to the wide, diverse stakeholders who are on both sides of the ecosystem or extremes of the ecosystem. So kudos to you and all of your team members who have been being the torch bearers of this space. And I'm sure that there's a lot that the Thai Forum has contributed to the audience who are here. So I'm sure that the audience could have learned some good perspectives, but nevertheless, there's something small which we could capture out of a vast ocean of knowledge you guys have in the last couple of years you've been working on this space, and a lot more to do. So my best wishes to both of you and for the coming up, the laurels that you'll take for your ventures. With this, I'll open up the questions for the audience. Over to you guys. Yeah. Any questions, I'll appreciate if they can ask or you can put on the chat box. Please feel free to ask the questions. Okay. Till the time people start asking questions. Okay, let me ask a couple of questions. Although I know, but for the benefit of the audience, let me ask a couple of questions. I'll start with Satya this time. So Satya, what is that? It's not just beyond the kheti's aspect in general. You know, what are the other interesting things you see happening around in the rural space in terms of innovators or any other experiences you saw with other startups doing? What is something which got your attention? Could you just share your experience on that? Any new things you saw around?
Yeah. I think two things definitely are turning out to be quite exciting. I see over the next 5 years, the market side work is going to be more or less mainstream. So I would be surprised if if it is like 10 years, like 5 years might be aggressive, but 10 years, the effort on post-harvest, right? Be it the connection to the markets, the whole B2B, B2C ecosystem, there is, truckloads of money that is being pumped into that space. And I'm sure all that is being put to good use by, the smart fellow entrepreneurs. And that problem is something which I'm quite optimistic in the next 5 to 10 years is going to be more or less solved, like to a decent extent. And that's definitely exciting. The other space on which I wish more work happened, but already some work has started happening, is the precision farming space. I like one point that Vihari said. They don't claim themselves to be organic, but the customers read or feel it is safe, right? Mm-hmm. Ultimately, I think for not just an Indian context, even for the larger global context, given the kind of population we need to feed, I don't think it is reasonable or fair or environmentally viable to say we will just do only organic, right? It's not a single variable optimization. It's a multi-variable optimization of business, of environment, of farmer, customer, everybody, right? So there is a multi-variable optimization. So safe food, which gets to become a reality when more investment and more thoughts go into precision farming related aspects, I think is one space which is turning out to be exciting. We care about it. Vihari cares about it. Quite a few other people care about it. But I think many, many more people have to care about it. It is not enough. This is a space where it is not enough. Many, many more people have to care about it for it to be solved at scale. So these are the two things which come to my mind.
Very interesting. And we've always been hearing from the news that the farmers' sons don't become farmers. But on the contrary, from last 5 years, my experience and all the entrepreneurs, I'm sure you must have all witnessed, a lot of non-agri entrepreneurs like you guys and more who are beyond the league, who are actually getting into the agri space and trying to disrupt this whole space. And that's what is actually bringing a little bit of impact into the whole innovation spree. So thank you so much, guys, for your passion. So let me ask Vihari the similar question. What has been your, learning in terms of what has been happening new in hydroponic space? Anything which caught your attention or anything which you feel like sharing in terms of hydroponics that you feel is going to disrupt this whole space beyond what you guys are doing?
I think it's a very large market, right? And we really want to see a couple of more players coming into this space and make our life easy a little. I think what we should do is we should grow as a community, right? There's no competition. I'm sure everybody as an ag player is either solving a consumer side problem or a farmer side problem, right? Both are on an impact scale. It's not like a fintech, that I need to get more payments through my platform, or it's not like a Swiggy, or it's not like, it's not where it's just purely transactional, because every ag startup somewhere deep down started because they wanted to create an impact into someone's lives, right? Sure. So I think what we feel is that mostly most of the startups in ag space are very competitive. They don't generally gel well together because they feel that it's a competition. But what I honestly feel that it should be more collaborative, where when we're working towards a common cause of creating impact, I think the faster we get to the goal, the better it is. Right? So we should be able to reach that faster only when we tag along with everyone and then move faster. There can be a lot of synergies with a lot of ag players, and you're part of the incubator, right? So you've connected us in the past to a lot of other ag players to work along with. And so, and that's something which we really look forward to, bridging the gaps, seeing collaborations. Someone is just building an IoT for monitoring soil health and so on, right? So they can work with Kethi, right? And then suddenly the impact is just multifold. Instead of them searching for farmers, them onboarding farmers, it's a win-win. Right? So that's something which I really expect it could happen in the ag space.
I think that is the power of collaboration and co-creation, Vihari. I think you rightly pointed out that is much needed in the agri-tech space. And I could definitely, draw the inference or take a feel of, while you both were interacting, there could be some areas of synergies, with respect to what Urban Kisan is doing and what Kethi is trying to do. There could be commonalities of area which will not only help you guys grow as starters, but I'm sure that the whole ecosystem will get benefited. Currently, there's a little bit of ecosystem that you're catering in terms of urban and rural, but there'll be definitely a crossover that I see coming forward for you guys. But taking the clue, last question to both of you guys, very short, I would want you to kind of give a final message from both of you, starting with Satya and then Vihari, as to what is your message to the young entrepreneurs or any entrepreneurs who wish to get into agri-tech space. So over to you guys.
I think there's only one message. This sector is super interesting, and it's a sunrise sector, super interesting, but we have to solve real problems, right? So get to a real problem. Don't solve an illusionary, imaginary problem just because it sounds cool on a tech platform.
True. Yeah.
Sorry. Once you get to a real problem, and get to understand the customer, it's a fascinating thing. You can see how, whether it is Vihari giving food to, a customer who feels happy feeding their young kids at home, or us being able to see that impact on farmer side, it's quite fulfilling. It really completes us.
Wonderful. Thank you. Vihari, over to you.
Yeah, I think the only message is, irrespective of whether it's an ag or not ag, is once you're in the startup journey, you should know that nothing is going to happen overnight. There is no small project. Everything is a moonshot. especially in ag, because nothing is under your control, nor is the weather, nor is your farmer, nor the entire standard of living. Nothing is in your control. So with like like he started saying, the odds are always against you when you're in ag. When all goes well, suddenly you'll see something going wrong somewhere in one part of the farm. So if you're especially coming in ag, then you better be prepared for the next 5-6 years if you really want to make an impact. So.
Very interesting. So that brings two important elements. What Satya said is very interesting. You talk about some realistic problems, which are really pressing problems of agriculture, which is a very, very crucial thing. The starting point, and that is a basis pillar on which the whole story revolves, whether it be 5 years or 10 years down the line, which is what Vihari interestingly brought down, is if you're getting into agritech, it's a long-term space. It's not a valuation game. It is not going to be easy. It is definitely going to be difficult, but having said that, it is going to be beautiful. It's going to be interesting and fascinating, as what Satya was talking about. These two elements go hand in hand, solving realistic and pressing problems for agritech and the farmers of this country who are backbone for this country. 60% of Indian population is dependent on agriculture, number one. Number two, you're talking about realistic problems, many challenges across agriculture, production, supply chain, warehousing, logistics, food, delivery, every place there's a challenge. And that is where today, even beyond the research ecosystem and the agri-business companies, today we are seeing a spree of agri-tech startups which are solving challenges across the farm to fork. And added to these both clues of solving real problems and staying on it, what Vihari says, there's a third element is ecosystem. That's what my perspective comes. We are here as ecosystem, as AgHub, AID, or multiple agri-tech incubators, a league of guys who are enablers on this side. We are just at the backstory for building so many startups to build them in order to be able to bring these startups to the success and to be able to help these startup founders fulfill their dreams and actually fulfill their dreams to be able to solve the farmers or the agriculture stakeholders' problems. So these three things are the whole crux of the story: solving problems, staying on it, being patient on it, and working with the ecosystem, the incubators, accelerators, the agriculture institutions, the agriculture stakeholders. That's where the non-ag guys meet ag guys to be able to figure out a healthy balance of the secret recipe to be able to come with very balanced products, solutions, you call it, or tech, agri-tech, agri-business, the whatever you call it, the technologies, whether you call it products or services. These are the kind of recipes we need to come with innovative solutions or delivery models to be able to serve the ag ecosystem. So this is here, the whole story of how the hydroponics, the urban farming vis-a-vis the rural entrepreneurship, the kind of model which customizes the farmers is here. So we had two interesting startup founders, Mr. Vihari and Mrs. Satya, who gave the whole story of how they started and how they are here. And I'm sure it is just a starting and there's a lot more that they are going to do. So let's keep watching their story and I'm sure we'll be able to find both of them on LinkedIn. And thank you so much, guys, for sparing your valuable time. I'm sure you must be busy in your own businesses, but thank you on behalf of Tai and also on my personal behalf for sparing time with us. And thank you, Tai, for looping me in. And thank you all the audience for your patient hearing. Thank you and good night.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks, thank you. Vijay. Thanks, the entire team at Tai and the audience. Yeah, you can find with the same name on LinkedIn and we can connect. Thank you all. Bye-bye. Yeah.
Thank you, everyone. Thanks, Vihari.